you have a Bible, turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, or chapter 4. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13. I'm going to read one verse. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13. Being defamed, we entreat. We are made as the filth of this world and of the offscouring of all things unto this day. In Paul's writing to the Corinthian church, Paul has evidently been having some trouble with attitude about the way things are going in his life. I wonder today, is anybody here ever had problem with your attitude about the way things are going in your life? Paul had been through the mill, and it didn't really look like anybody cared. You'll see by the terminology he uses here in verse 13, he says, we are made as the filth of this world and of the offscouring of all things until this day. I want to talk to you this morning about that phrase in the middle of this verse. The filth of the world. Let's bow our heads and pray. Lord, as we come to you today, we're thankful for the privilege of being in church on Sunday morning. We're thankful, Lord, for the songs that have been sung and the message that's been in the song. God, I pray today that while I'm speaking, I pray that you'll remove any obstacle from my mind, anything, Lord, that would hinder what you've laid on my heart. I pray, dear God, that you'll talk to people on the inside while I talk to them on the outside. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. In his writing here, Paul, you can see a lot in Paul's writing in the Corinthian church. But I want you to turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. I want to show you some of the things that Paul was going through. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, he said, are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more. In labors, more abundant. In stripes, above measure. In prisons, more frequent. In deaths, oft. Of the Jews, 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. Thrice was I beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. A night and a day I have been in the deep. In journeyings often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils by mine own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watching often, in hunger and thirst, in fasting often, in cold and nakedness. Paul is saying that we, the apostles, the greatest men that ever lived, are become the filth of this world. He said, we become the scum of the earth. We have become the dregs of all things. He says, the offscouring of all things unto this day. Something was going on in Paul's life as he wrote this that he realized, all of a sudden he realized who he was doing it for. He was doing it for Jesus. And as Paul wrote this, he was saying something like this. I believe he was saying a few things that I believe you and I need to hear today. First of all, Paul was saying, guys, I don't have any reputation, so there's really nothing to fight about. Once he realized what was going on in his life, once he came to the place in his life where he realized I'm going through pain and suffering and defeat and agony and gloom and despondency, and he names all the things that he had gone, that had gone on in his life, and Paul says, guys, I'm doing it for him. It's all about him. It's not about me. It's not about me. It's not about the church. It's not about my ministry. It's not about any. It's all about Jesus. So Paul says, guys, I don't have any reputation, so there's nothing to fight about. In verse 10, he says, we're fools for Christ. See, An old preacher one time told me, he said, you watch your character and God will take care of your reputation. Amen. We're so concerned about our reputation, aren't we? I mean, everybody in this building, we're concerned about a reputation. You know what? I've had a hard time in my life with my reputation. You get reputed as being something, reputed as being strong, a good preacher, if you please, reputed for having good standards, for having a fast-growing church. Every church that I've ever pastored, you know, grew pretty rapidly. To be able to go out and speak and be an evangelist, all these things in my life that I've had this repute for being. But today I want to say to you, I stand before you today, I don't have a reputation. Because see, friends, my reputation has been nailed to a cross. I want you to understand that has to be the way that all of us view life and everything in our life. We don't have a reputation. Our reputation has got to be nailed to a cross. And since that has happened, there's nothing to fight about. I don't have a reputation. There's nothing to fight about. Paul is saying here, as he's writing to this troubled church, he says, I don't have a reputation, so there's nothing to fight about. He says, I have no ambition, so there's nothing to be jealous about. I have no ambition, so there's nothing to be jealous about. You ever gone through your life and looked around at people and say, well, why did they have this and I don't? Have you ever walked down and drove down through a neighborhood and say, I wonder why they have that nice house and I don't have that? Somebody drives up in a car that you desire and I wonder why they have that and I don't have that. I wonder why they have money and I don't have that. I wonder why they have an illustrious career and I don't have that. And the list goes on and on and on. See, we're ambitious people, aren't we? I mean, everybody in our own realm, we're ambitious people. I mean, but ambition doesn't leave room for he's the potter and I'm the clay. See, the ambition that I have as a mortal man, it does not leave room for he is in charge. He's the potter, I'm the clay. Ambition doesn't leave room for whatever it takes. Ambition doesn't leave room for wherever he leads, I'll go. It doesn't leave room for that. By the way, what is that roaring? Is there anybody in the building that could fix it? That would really help me if you would. Nobody can fix it. We're ambitious. What does it mean? Wherever he leads, I'll go. Would you quit your job? It's a question that needs to be answered. If Jesus said to you, if in your quiet time, would you quit your job and do what God told you to do? Would you leave the security you have to do the will of God? Would you? I mean, can you say, whatever it takes, God, whatever it takes, can you scrap your plans? Can you scrap your dreams? Can you scrap your ambition for his will? How about you teenagers? How about you young adults back there? I mean, has our ambition been nailed to a cross? All of my life, from the time that I was a young kid, I had great desire to go in the medical field. I had kind of a guy that I looked up to that was quite a bit older than I, and he had gone to the medical field, and I said, you know, that's what I want to do. So during my high school years, I crammed all the math and science I could. In fact, even in my senior year, I was taking college math and college science, and then I got into college and began to take quantitative analysis and qualitative analysis and calculus and all these math things, and because I wanted to be in the medical field, I wanted to make a lot of money. I'd made plans. There was a local businessman there in think that it made me some promises about business opportunities and things like that. But you know what? I had plans, dreams, ambition. Here's what I'm going to do. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to accomplish this. I'm going to have stuff. You know, I never did have much being raised as a child. Never did have a lot of money. Didn't live in a big home. Didn't have the best of the best. Never was hungry. Thank God for that. But I always wanted more. I had an ambition that was driving me. I want more. I want the stuff. I want to live the dream. I want to have my way in this thing. But you know what? When I got down in that ditch by the side of the road and gave my life to Jesus, all of that had to die. See, that ambition that was driving me had to die. And in that ditch, when I asked God to forgive me of my sins, when I told him there, if you'll save my soul, I'll do anything you want me to do. I'll go anywhere you want me to go. And Lord, well, here I am. I'm yours. God, if you'll just save me, God, I'm willing to be yours for the rest of my life. And I guarantee you, God changed my plan. God changed my dream. God changed what I wanted to be. God changed all that in an instant, because one day when we come to the stage in our life when we say, God, I don't have any ambition. My ambition's been nailed to a cross. So there's nothing to be jealous about. Well, number three, I have no possessions, so there's nothing to worry about. Does that make any sense? I have no possessions, so there's nothing to worry about. See, we spend our time worrying about things, possessions, money, getting ahead in life, how to keep what we've got, how to keep our money, how to keep our stuff, how to keep our standing. I mean, and we forget what the psalmist said in Psalm 24, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. We forget what Psalm 50 says, for every beast of the forest is mine and the cattle upon 1,000 hills. We forget that, but it's there. Matthew chapter 19, verse 29 says, and every one that hath forsaken houses, or brethren, or sisters, or father, or mother, or wife, or children, or lands, for my name's sake, shall receive 100-fold, and shall inherit everlasting life. I don't own anything. I said, I don't own anything. It all belongs to him. I mean, if we could ever in this life get that down in our heart, I don't own anything. It all belongs to him. I used to sing a song that said, bought with a price, I am not my own, for I belong to Jesus. All of my dreams, all of my money, all of the thing, my family, everything I have, it all belongs to him. And see, Paul is saying, folks, I've been through the mill. I've gone through anything you want to name. And he says, well, as I've come through this, I've realized that I don't have a reputation, so there's nothing to fight about. I have no ambition, so there's nothing to be jealous about. I don't have any possessions, so there's nothing to worry about. I don't own anything. Philippians chapter 3 says, yea, doubtless, and I counted all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. He says, and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. Then he says this, that I might know him, and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. Paul had figured some things out as he was going through life, and he was doing life, and he was facing all the obstacles of life. Some things that unless this church, unless we as individuals figure out, we're never going to be at that place in our life that God would desire for us to be. Paul says, I don't have any reputation. There's nothing to fight about. I don't have any ambition, so there's nothing to be jealous about. I don't have any possessions, so there's nothing to worry about. And then number four, and I close. He says, I don't have any rights, so therefore I can't be done wrong. We worry about our rights being violated, don't we? We live in a rights-oriented society. My rights. We do that in our society. We do that in our country. We do that in our homes. We do that in our marriage. We do that on the workplace. I want you to understand, folks, once we come to the place in our life where we say, I don't have any rights because my rights have been nailed to a cross. I don't have any rights, so I can't be done wrong. I mean, Christ, he suffered and died and said, as he was there, and they were beating him, and they were mocking him and cursing him, pulling out his beard and spitting in his face. And finally, when they hung him up on a cross, he looked down from that old rugged cross and he said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. He gave up his rights. He'd done that before he left the heavenlies. He did it again so we could see it on planet Earth. He was there in the Garden of Gethsemane. He said, Lord, I don't want to go through this. Oh, I don't want to suffer this. I don't want to have to go through the crucifixion. But in the same breath, he said, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. There may be things we don't want to go through. There's a situation we're facing that we don't want to face. Things to deal with we don't want to deal with. But we've got to come to the place where we say, Lord, it's all about you. It's not about me. Oh, God, I don't have any rights. So I can't be done wrong. Stephen, one of the deacons in the early church, a deacon evangelist. Because of his stand for Christ, of his love for Christ, they stoned him. Took rocks and beat out his brains. But the rocks were falling down on him, beating out his life. Stephen looked up and he saw Jesus standing at the right hand of God, it says. And he said, Father, lay not this sin to their charge. Stephen had surrendered his life, his rights. I don't have any rights, so I can't suffer any wrong. Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, right after he rehearsed all the things that he'd gone through. I mean, and right after he said, I've been beaten. I've been left for dead. I've been stoned. I've been left over a wall. He said, I've been in the ocean a day and a half. He said, I've been shipwrecked on an island. He says, the church didn't like me. The world didn't like me. My friends didn't like me. Everybody forsook me. And he names all these things that happened to him. And then here's what he said in verse 17. He says, for our light affliction. What? They've tried to kill him countless times. I mean, stoned him at Lystra. Beat him, I mean, 3 times he got beat nearly to death. And all these other things. He said, I've been betrayed, I've been abandoned, I've been misaligned, I've been lied on, I've been accused of stuff. He said, the church even didn't do me right. And then he has the nerve, the audacity to say, but our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. We're so afraid of our rights being violated. Look up here and listen to me. We're so afraid of our rights being violated. We're so afraid that we won't be recognized. We're so afraid that we won't be appreciated, that we won't be applauded, that we won't be accepted. Folks, we don't have any rights. Those rights have been nailed to a cross. I want to close with this statement. Paul, after rehearsing all the events in his life and all the catastrophes and the hurts and the wrongs and all the pain and agony and suffering he'd gone through, Paul says, I'm already dead, so no one can kill me. I want you to go to Romans chapter 6, verse 1. Paul is writing to the Roman church. He said, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized unto Jesus Christ were baptized unto his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. He said, for we have been planted together in the likeness of his death. We should also in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him. Did you read verse 6? That our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now he said, okay, does that mean after that we've been physically, our life has ended physically, then we're going to, no, that's not what Paul's saying. Paul's still living. And he says, but he that's dead is freed from sin. He said in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 31, he said, I protest by rejoicing which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord. I die daily. And then in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, Paul says, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, that's this life we're living down here on earth. We're breathing air and blood's coursing through our veins. He said, in the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I'm crucified. Many other scriptures, Paul alludes to this fact. I'm crucified. Jesus alluded to that fact. It says we have to die. An oxymoron, if you please. We have to die in order to live. I remember in time past, I laid John on an altar years ago. I'm not going to do that this morning. But if you can imagine a dead man over here in a casket laying in our building, I could bring the prettiest woman, as scantily clad as you'd want to make her up, and parade her there in front of him with perfume and makeup. Would he be tempted? Why? No! Why? Because he's dead. I could offer drugs to him and say, hey, drugs make you high. Is he tempted? No, he's dead. I could offer him some whiskey, say, you want a drink, buddy? Hey, you look like you need one. No. He's dead. I could offer him a pile of money, a wheelbarrow of money, say, hey, buddy, would you like to have this money? Listen, is it going to do? No, he's dead. I can offer him position. I can say, you can be president, but what's it going to do? I mean, he's laying over there dead. Is it going to cause him? No, he's dead. Worldly fame, etc. No, he's dead. Galatians 6:14 says, but God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me and I unto the world. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 24, he says, and they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lust. In Galatians 6, he says, but God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus, by whom the world is crucified unto me and I unto the world. The filth of this world that Paul referred to in our text is trodden underfoot. And Paul says that we are become the filth of this world. We're watching the news and CNN, and the whole world is upset about what's going on all around the world with ISIS, with all the radical groups that are rising up. And I want you to understand, folks, this is nothing new. It's been going on ever since time began. There's a war going on between good and evil. But here's where we're at. Have we come to the place in our life where we can say this? Hey, I'm already dead. You can't kill me. I don't have any rights. You can't do me wrong. I don't have any possessions, so there's nothing to worry about. I have no ambition, so there's nothing to be jealous about. I have no reputation, So there's nothing for us to fight about. All those things have been nailed to a cross. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 says, "For we're bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." 1 Corinthians 7:23 says, "You are bought with a price, you are not the servants of men." There's been several times in my lifetime that I've had to come to the place to where I've had to ask God to take my life. Years ago, you've heard me tell it many times, but Bob Williams, and he was raised in this church. Bob Williams went with me, and I remember one time Bob praying, and we were prayer partners, and Bob looking across the altar and said, "You know what we need to do?" He bragged on my preaching. He bragged on my singing. He bragged on my personality. He bragged on what a great guy I was, and I was in loving it. I was enjoying it. I mean, this is going to be a good prayer time because somebody's liking me. Somebody's loving me. It's all about me. Hey, go Curtis. He's our man. If he can't do it, nobody can. Good day. And then he looked at me right in the eye and said, "You know what we need to pray for, Curtis?" And I said, "What's that?" He said, "We need to pray that God will kill you." "What? That God will..." He said, "Yeah, because I've been noticing something in you." He said, "Curtis, I've been seeing that you're enjoying the accolades. You're enjoying the praise. You're enjoying the applause. You're enjoying all the stuff that comes with ministry." And he said, "We need to pray that Curtis Linton will die so that Jesus can live in him." And I got down on my face in the carpet and I asked God to kill me. At a Topeka shopping center, Fairview Mall, Topeka, Kansas, listening to a song of a glory in the cross right in the middle of a Christian bookstore. God got a hold of my heart. He broke my heart, and I had to run to the car, and I had to spend some time with God and say, "God, you've got to kill me." I could talk to you about a time that has happened in Russia. I could talk to you about many times that I've went down to a road ditch where I accepted Christ as my Savior and got down in that ditch and says, "God, there's things coming up, there's rising up, the lust of my flesh, the lust of my eyes, the pride of this life that I'm involved in. Oh, God, it's got to die. Curtis Lynn has got to die once again. It's not a one-time thing. It's a daily thing." Paul says, "I die daily." And maybe it's been a while since some in this building have literally come to God and say, "God, it's time for my rights, my ambition, all these things that I hold so dear. It's time for them to die." See, it's got to be every day. It's not just a feely-feely time after a song or after a good service, something that scratched our itch. But it's got to be an ongoing thing. That's why we believe that sanctification is a continual thing. It's progressive. It every day with Jesus, sweeter than the day before. As we give an altar call here in a few minutes, it's time to come to the place of death. See, these altars here have always been a place of death. The sacrifice that was offered on these altars represented sin that had to die. Jesus, when he hung on the cross, represented sin. He became sin who knew no sin. I believe it's time for some of us, listen very closely to me. I had a wonderful message prepared, alliterated, and everything just all beautiful, and to the point worked on it for some time, laid out, ready to go this morning, and I guarantee you God changed my heart. God done something in my heart. There's been people coming to me this morning saying, "Allergies bothering you?" I've had six people say, "Your allergies bothering you?" "No, my allergies not bothering you. The Lord's been bothering me." Because if there's anything this church needs, we can hone our music until it's sharper than a razor. We can make our preaching sharp. We can make it nice. We can make it hermeneutically correct. We can be expositionaries of God's word. We can do all those things. But until we as an individual and we as a church come to the point where Paul says, I'm crucified with Christ. It's not about me. It's about Him. You young people back there, have you come to that place in your life where you can say, it's not about me? It's about Him. I lay myself, I lay my will, I lay my pride, I lay my ambition, I lay my rights, I lay my possession on the cross, and I say, I am crucified with Christ, yet I no longer live. Jesus now lives in me. I hope the guys have got a song. Have you got the song ready? We can do it. I want you to see this before I close this sermon. I would have had the ensemble get it ready, but I just did this a few minutes ago. But I want you to listen real close. I want to ask you to do something. I want you to lay your cell phone down. I want you to even lay your Bible down for a minute. And I want you to listen and look at this song, because this is what Christianity is all about. And I want to ask you, have you done this? Play it.
When I look back at what I thought was living, I'm amazed at the price I chose to pay. And to think I ignored what really I thought the sacrifice would be too great. When I finally reached the point of giving in, I found the cross was calling even then. Even though it took dying to survive, I never felt so much alive.
Not in vain.
He looked at his family as he gathered around his bed. He said, nothing to prove. Nothing to lose. Nothing to hide. Nothing to prove. Nothing to lose. Nothing to hide. The filth of this world, he said, the obscuring of all things. I believe there's people in this building today that need to walk down an aisle, get on their knees at this altar. We forget what the word means, don't we? To come to this place of death and say, God, there's some things that need to die in my life. My ambition, my reputation, my possessions, my rights. They all have to die so Christ can live in me. Let's bow our heads.